Hey y'all, this is Kobe R. Rice coming back at you after almost 2 weeks of not talking to you guys. Sorry about that. Basically, I took the entire last week off just to relax and just to get centered and to get on point. And it really did me a whole world of good. Last week was spring break, so basically I was hanging out, not doing anything, but literally living in the most blissful space I could ever live in. And it was just great. After a really hellish, I don't know, almost 8 weeks to the start of this semester, trying to catch up with work, getting behind in work for graduate school, grading all these crazy papers for, 150 students. I really just needed a moment to unplug from graduate school completely and then just focus on me and what I wanted to do in making art. And it was just great. And actually, I'm gonna go through the specific things that I did between the 7th and now. But basically, during the week of spring break, I was able to really live the kind of life that I want to live literally until I die, which is making my own hours, because I get up anywhere between 4:30 a.m. and 6 a.m. every single morning like clockwork. Cause I just I'm a early bird. I'm not really a night owl because my brain just shuts down at night. But I am an early bird, and my mind is clear and just like connected and just like shooting off. Yes, at 4:30 in the morning. So I get up every day and I work. I work on my novels, I work on my screenplays, I take my classes that I'm trying to take on the side, which are like filmmaking classes, editing classes, writing classes, entrepreneurship classes, marketing classes, just all the classes. And I do a whole host of things that basically allow me to live exactly the kind of life that I want to live. As a creative full-time writer slash filmmaker slash everything else. And this spring break was really a wonderful opportunity to sort of reconnect with that ultimate desire. And so between now and literally May of 2019, it is my goal, my ultimate goal, to be able to work from home full time as a writer and as a filmmaker and as an entrepreneur, a creative entrepreneur that teaches creative like craft skills and also teaches marketing, teaches publishing, teaches filmmaking through the Bohemian Badass. So it was just great. I really just tried my best to get as centered as possible and put a lot of affirmations out there in terms of what exactly I want to do as with my life as a creative, as a professional. And I was just like, man, if I could just live this life every day and not just during spring break, this would be my ideal life. And it was great. I got to exercise a little bit, not too much. I actually need to fold that back into my schedule a little more. Although it's getting hotter in Arizona, so it's harder to do that. So I might do like a home gym sort of setup. Anyways, so it was just great. My typical daily schedule, like I said, was getting up early, writing, working on plot, working on world building, creative courses, cooking, sleeping, taking care of myself, like not really during the day. I took a nap or two, but I slept a lot more during spring break. And if you can't see, it's showing in my skin, which is looking delightful today, even if I do say so myself. Mwah. And so it was just great. So I don't want to ramble on about how amazing my spring break was, and how I want my spring break to be like my entire life for the whole thing. Let's get into the more specific into more specific things. So the last time I talked to you guys, it was March 7th. And excuse me if I'm looking off screen this way, that way, up and down. It's because I'm referring either to my phone or I'm looking at my notes. Because if you guys remember, I do take, I am very meticulous and sort of OCD about how I spend my hours in my day. So I always want to track to make sure that I am spending the time wisely and that I'm doing what I need to do and not just you know, screwing around on the internet, on Facebook, arguing with people, whatever. So you guys are gonna get an update from March 7th all the way up until yesterday, because today is a new day. So basically, I did, again, a lot of marketing. As of like March 7th and a few days after that, I was still sort of wrapping up a lot of newsletter swaps and doing a lot of giveaways. And, you know, the giveaways are going to continue on my blog, on my newsletter monthly. But just to let you guys know, I'm actually gearing up for my second major giveaway of this year. And actually, I should probably try to recruit some people on board to share this giveaway with their followers, so we can sort of just get more people into the giveaway. But I'm thinking about offering an Amazon Echo along with a free year of Kindle Unlimited, or I might just offer one of those. But I kind of like those two things together, to be really honest with you. I'm trying to make the quarterly giveaways, you know, anywhere, but I'm trying to make the prizes for the quarterly giveaways anywhere between $100 to $200 to really kind of sweeten the pot. But the kind of prize I offer really depends on how many other authors I can get in the giveaway, because the larger the reach, the more valuable the prize is going to be, and the bigger the ROI will be. Because if it's just me offering this to my followers, and I do have separate giveaways that I do offer to my followers just to reward them and thank them for being on my list. But if I'm just offering like the big, big giveaways to my followers, it doesn't really help to generate any new subscribers onto the list and new, you know, people who can enjoy different authors' works. So yeah, I'm trying to make that my big second quarter push. So we'll see. I'll update you guys on that and see where we can go, because it's sort of getting late in the game, right? In any case, so that's what's happening with marketing. I finally finished up in its completion the Black Finance, the Black Money 102 course, and some of Tiffany the Budgetista's Live Richer challenges, again, along with my creative path as an entrepreneur or aspiring emerging entrepreneur, and along with my just me being a writer and filmmaker. Like, I think it's also very important for you guys and for me too to get your personal and business finances and your business financial health on point. Because if you really want to create a sustainable career as a creative person, the financial and the marketing and the business side of it is undeniable. You can't really just create. And if you're an independent creative, you can't just create stuff and not take heed with the rest of your life and the other part of the business, which is the business part. If you are someone like James Patterson and you don't have to worry really that much about marketing or what have you, then by all means, just sit and write, and, you know, more power to you. Wish I was in your position. Actually, email me so you can tell me how to get into your position, because I would love to be in that position. But if you're in that position and you don't have to focus on the management of your business, then this segment of my update might not be for you. But for everybody else who is wanting to be an independent, an independently owned, operated, run business that is based off of your creative skills and craft, for all of you guys, we need to get our personal finances together and our business finances. And on top of it, excuse me, actually, let me just make a correction. I'm pretty sure James Patterson has his stock portfolio on point. I mean, he's literally a millionaire. And I'm sure that money is not just like being spent on like hookers and blow. I'm pretty sure it's being invested, and he's created an estate and wealth for himself. And that takes a certain level of financial planning, financial organization, and just an investment in one's own personal financial life. So even if you are James Patterson or someone like him, still get your personal finances on point. Your future self will thank you. Your children will thank you. Okay, so that's my little spiel. Anyway, so again, if you're looking to get involved in managing your finances and have a, like, literally a digestible step-by-step process through which you can figure out how to sell real estate, figure out how to invest in stocks, figure out how to start like a savings plan, or you want to know the difference between an IRA or a Roth IRA. All those things are covered in the Black Money 102 course. He also has sort of separate offshoot courses. Like he has one entire course on real estate and investing in real estate. He has a separate course on just stocks. And I think they're called the blackrealestate.com and the blackstockscourse.com. I have to find out the actual links and I'll put them below. And again, if you're not Black, African American, African, Afro-Caribbean, that's totally fine. You know, like this, you can, this is the same information. You can still learn a lot from it. It's just that, again, Dr. Boyce Watkins is very invested in trying to harness the power of the black dollar, seeing as, we're still trying to unwrap or disentangle ourselves from the historical and institutional racism and discrimination we've experienced as a people, which definitely included a lot of financial oppression, redlining, a lot of really predatory loan practices, which still go on today, segregation, like physical and just existential. So, I'm not here to give a history lesson. If you're an American and you've read any sort of modicum of truthful history, you'll know about this. But just to reiterate, that's the reason why he calls it the Black Money Course, because he wants to empower Black people. But that doesn't mean that you can't be empowered and you can't learn from his courses if you're white, Asian, Hispanic, Latina, Latinx, Peloponnesian. It doesn't matter where you're from or what your creed is, what your race is. You can learn a lot from this course, and it's given in bite-sized chunks, so it's really easy to digest. Anyway, so let's move on from that. And I'm just gonna scroll through all these days and pick out the most important things that I have done and accomplished. So up until really like Friday, March 10th, I was working mostly on graduate school stuff. Yay. But one of the big things that has happened recently is, and I don't know if I announced this to you guys in the last update, but the Iron Maiden, which is coming along great, actually, excuse me, recently turned into two novels, not because I'm super ambitious or even crazy, or maybe I am. Maybe that's sort of like the sub reason, but the Iron Maiden was just getting so long. Like it was getting close to 200,000 words and it still wasn't done. And I was just like, there is clearly two novels here. There are like two distinct arcs and I need to distinguish between those two arcs. So the Iron Maiden will actually be the next book that I'm writing after this current book. So I basically split the Iron Maiden in two. And now I have what is called Hollow Point, which is the next book in the Books of Ezekiel series that's coming up. It's already over 100,000 words, but this book is actually like closer to completion because I have distilled a very clear storyline, especially for the main character, Ezekiel Annan. I've distilled her storyline into one distinguishable arc, as well as distilled the other character storylines into arcs that make sense and that all sort of intertwine as usual. Because that's how I roll with this series. It's a multiple POV novel, sort of in the style of, oh my God, how am I fucking up this guy's name? The Game of Thrones guy. And I know like you guys are gonna freaking destroy me for forgetting his name, but sometimes I confuse him with Tolkien because of the way that they do their initials. Unacceptable, no excuses, but yeah, so I sort of am making the books of Ezekiel, like sort of structuring it from a multiple person perspective. And so that requires that, like, not only do you have an overall storyline, but that you have a very clear arc for each of your characters that you're going to follow, even if those arcs do not intersect with one another. So, yeah, so that's basically what has happened. George R.R. Martin, Sorry about that, guys. Please don't crucify me. That's the writer of Game of Thrones. And it's an amazing series. There's like no reason why I should have forgotten his name. but basically, so Hollow Point is coming. I foresee a release date of July 3rd. Because it's coming, I'm working on it every single day. It's coming along steadily. Like there's more direction and, yeah, so that's exciting. So, if you are tuned in to the book order of the series, book one is called The Given, book two is called The Taken, book three is now Hollow Point, followed by The Iron Maiden, Blood and Ink, The House of Death, Chase the Devil, and The Last Descent. So that is what is coming in that series. And as you guys know, I'm not just writing book after book after book. These books are sort of in seasonal arcs. So The Given and The Taken is pretty much in one seasonal arc, as though you were watching a season of television, right? There's a clear beginning and a clear end for that arc. The books from Hollow Point all the way up to The Last Descent, that is another seasonal arc. So if we were doing television instead of novels, basically, The Given and The Taken would be season one, and the books from Hollow Point all the way to The Last Descent would be season two. Actually, it would be too long to be a full season of television. You'd probably have to divide it into like, I would say probably three seasons, but in terms of like, you know, the pursuit of the final page, which is like the main push of this season that I'm writing now. Hollow Point starts off that season and The Last Descent ends that season arc. There's actually another arc. It's an invisible arc, but it's like the prelude arc, which I call The Sins of Cabal, which basically show us like the life prior to the life of Ezekiel Annan prior to The Given and The Taken. Her life, her friend Julianne Favre's life, her relationship with Jonathan Quinn, and then it also talks about the political life and strife between the alchemic orders and the civic order, so that you know, we finally know for sure why they are at war and how that all started. You don't need to have read that prelude arc. It's just in my mind. That's sort of the foundational premise of the entire series, because The Given and the rest of the series takes care of all of that knowledge as well. But, you know, preludes are always great and they're always fun to read. You know, actually seeing characters in action rather than seeing, like, the results of their treachery or rather than experiencing them through hearsay. Because as you guys know, the books of Ezekiel are mainly from Ezekiel Annan's perspective. And the prelude series towards before all this even happened is from the other perspectives of the other people involved in the alchemic order and the civic order, which is always interesting, I think, to see who came before. Anyway, so that was longer than I expected, that update on the books of Ezekiel. So that happened. Another major, major thing that happened, which I was so excited about, is that my colleague and I finally have shot our short film home, and the footage looks really fantastic. And I say fantastic with the caveat that we are both first-time filmmakers. I mean, we've made a couple of our own short films independently in the past because we were both studying filmmaking and screenwriting at the University of Wisconsin-Madison through like a couple of courses. And so we've collaborated in the past before, not on those short films, but on a play festival. And now we're collaborating on this short film home, which is just like a short sort of indie experimental film. And, you know, my colleague is the director and the writer. I'm the producer and the DP, which I thought was a really terrible idea at first. Sorry, I have a cold, so if I'm, like, just blowing my nose, excuse me. I'm the producer, and then I became the DP, which I was terrified of because I know that I will never be a good DP. Not a good one. I can be a good one, but I will never be, like, at the level that I need to be in order to make a film look really, really gorgeous in terms of like camera movement and stuff. What I can do, and I know I can do, is one, work with actors, and two, design color palettes. I can also design shots. I sort of know like my vision as a director, like when I want to push in, when I want to pull back, when I want a pan and a follow, and I know how to direct. Well, I'm learning how to direct, but I'm starting to realize that I have like a pretty decent handle on like vision. I'm just trying to like upgrade my vision. But in terms of like literally holding the camera and like moving in, moving out, getting that perfect shot, and like I can't be a camera operator and I can't be a DP, but I can be a damn good director who has a really solid, crisp, gorgeous vision, who can work with a DP, who can then translate that vision into what I needed to be translated into. But what I did enjoy about the experience, aside from the fact that we still got some damn good footage, like some gorgeous, amazing footage, despite the fact that I was learning on the fly, what was helpful for me was that by using the camera, I got to know the camera better. I got to know the sort of like my instincts actually caught on pretty quick in terms of when to use a prime lens and when to use a telephoto lens. And some of you sitting there who are more experienced than I am or whatever might be saying, well, duh, it's easy. For me, I'm not really the best at grasping abstract ideas. I need to actually like do it, or they need to be like very concrete. So if you're sitting there talking to me about focal length, ISO, aperture, all that stuff, like, okay, I can commit that to memory, but honestly, until I have the camera in my hand and I have the lenses and I have the and I'm playing around with the camera and figuring out what works, like none of that means anything to me. Like I actually was watching tutorials the other day before we went out on this shoot, to sort of get an understanding of how to use ISO and the aperture in conjunction with each other. And all these tutorials are very clear, but it wasn't really until I picked up the camera and I started to say, oh, okay, like it's really bright out here. Let me use a lower ISO because, it lets in less light. Whereas in, when I'm inside, I need to use a higher ISO. Or if I want to shoot a horror film, right, I can shoot with the inside of my space completely bright, but if I lower the ISO or close the aperture, it'll give that dark horror look. Like, there's no way I would have been able to learn that by just watching a whole bunch of tutorials. I mean, it could have prepared me mentally for it, but until I got onto the set and started playing around and started figuring stuff out, there was no way for me to sort of pick up all that information abstractly. So I say that to say that it's good to go to classes. It's good to learn from, YouTube University and Google Grad School. I swear by those two things, like all my life, that those are the primary ways that I tend to learn about stuff. But you really have to go out into the world. And it doesn't have to be that far. You could just like sit in your house and just play around with your camera or go outside and just shoot stuff and just test stuff out. Decide that you want this shot versus that shot and figure out how to create that shot by using your different lenses, by using different filters, by going into different lighting spaces and figuring out, what kind of lighting schemes you want by just buying a cheap, set of lights with filters. And buy filters for your camera lenses so that you figure out, okay, these color schemes are working great together to create this effect. These color schemes are working great together to create that effect. This is important, even if you're not going to be a DP, because as a director, you can tell them specifically, listen, we're going to do like a lot of fluorescent lighting. I want a lens that is going to make the film look good. In that case, you would have to use like a purple lens, as far as I've heard, in order to make the film look like not washed out. But at the same time, I also want this color scheme along with the fluorescent lighting. And you're able to have a conversation on a different level with the DP when you know the terminology and you've experienced these scenarios yourself. And so I found that entire film shoot not only educational and inspiring, but also just it just showed me that I could actually be a decent DP. I'm never going to study it to the point where, and like I'm not going to make a career as a DP. That's not really for me. I personally prefer directing and writing. and a lot of the pre-production stuff. But now I'm developing a working toolbox and language wherein I can communicate with my future DPs and say, hey, this is what I want, and use a certain language, and then it gets done. The other thing that shooting this film also taught me is that, like, I can do this. Like, it doesn't have to, I mean, obviously I want to work up to doing bigger shoots, but I can do this. You know, I can take a camera and go out and shoot great footage, even if it's just me, or even if it's just me and two other people. Like, we can go and make films, and your films don't have to be like on the level of like Marvel Avengers. They can still be really great, like, great films focusing on character, focusing on story, just small little films, or even medium-sized films, or even big-sized films. Because once you master a certain level of filmmaking, you always want to sort of upgrade and get your skills. But it just taught me and my colleague, like, oh, this doesn't have to be nerve-wracking, and their perfection is not important. It's about just doing it and learning it and getting better with each try. And learning on the job. Like, I mean, you really, honestly, filmmaking is a career of sort of action, not inaction, wherein you learn the most and you gain the most success and momentum by actually doing it. And you can do it. Like, if I can do it, I literally, like, picked up my camera maybe two or three times before we went out to the shoot. And I read the manual, I looked online for tutorials, I tested stuff out, and we still got some pretty amazing footage. I mean, you guys are going to see it when we finally cut this little short film together and put it out there. Or maybe, I don't know if my colleague wants to, it's her film, really. But I can do whatever I want with the footage, which is great. So I think she's going to go for like an indie drama type film. I'm going to go for like a horror short, because that's what I want to do. So, yeah. Oh, sort of lost my chain of thought. But basically, in short, like, you can do this. You just have to get out there and do it. And now that I've done it, not only do I know how to use the camera better and sort of take more control of all the tools in my toolbox, but I also realize, okay, like, this is the size crew that I need for my production. These are the things I need to consider for my production. Just learning from the little mistakes we made on this small production, learning, you know, what kind of sound, for example, is being picked up in certain locations. And these are things that I learned in class already, but you have to sort of be out there and doing it just to sort of have it integrated into your mind in a useful way. You know, where I know where I can shoot certain films and where it wouldn't be so great to shoot certain films. I know how to now, like, prepare my environment for shooting. I'm thinking a lot about ADR, because even in those places where you can't, you literally can't do anything but film because the sound is going to be so bad, you have to literally create an environment then for that portion of the film. You have to create the ambient noise. You have to create, you know, the Foley. You have to create the ADR. So I'm starting to come up with a protocol and a process through which I am going to be able to shoot my own horror film this summer. So that's pretty exciting. And I actually think I'm going to do this every other weekend until the semester is over, just taking like a day, not even, probably like half a day, to shoot footage and just work with it and figure out what went wrong, what went great, and then just practice my editing skills. Along with that, as you guys know, I'm also putting together a video essay / documentary for my film 696 class, Race, Class, and Gender, which is one of the requirements of my graduate program. So, and prior to this, I also put together a small 15-minute, I wouldn't even call it a sizzle reel, but like sort of a video essay or a video overview of reality television for my my theater production experience when I was working on Creeps. So this semester, not only am I getting experience with like actual shooting, but I'm getting back into a lot of editing And so that's fun and that's interesting. And it's a lot easier than I thought. I mean, that's not to say that editing is easy and that whatever. Like, you still have to learn things. There's a lot that I have to learn, but it's not overwhelmingly difficult the way that I thought it would be. And it's manageable. If it's manageable for me, it's going to be manageable for you, trust me. It's just a great time right now for me in terms of developing my filmmaking skills and like taking that next step in shooting a film. And I'm also going to be diving into visual effects soon as well. So that's all exciting as usual. Okay, so this is getting long, so I'm going to actually wrap this up because it's getting long. Okay. So there wasn't really much else that I did that week. Spent some time with my sweet pea, my little girl, and then pretty much all throughout spring break, I didn't do a daily breakdown of what I did. That was just like too tedious, and I was in relaxation mode. But I did make a list, of all the things that I did. I wrote a lot for Hollow Point. I also did a lot of plot building and world building for Hollow Point. And the character journeys are just coming along great. They're looking amazing right now. I'm really excited as to what you guys are gonna get for the Hollow Point novel. There's like a lot of high octane action, excuse me, a lot of drama, a lot of just mysteries unraveling, and then more mysteries coming up. It's just really great. I really love it. I also did a lot of plotting and outlining for the Sandman screenplay, which is that movie I'll be filming this summer, that horror movie. I also worked on the plot for Rose and John Doe's, which again is the first novel in my Hitmen of Happily Ever After series. So that's really exciting. And then surprisingly, I also, because I just needed to get out of my head for Books of Ezekiel for like a day or so, I worked on a little bit of world building and plot for a novel series that's coming out in 2018 called Asylum. And I've been talking about Asylum for a while now, but that is actually at a point where I know for a fact by 2018 I'll be able to write that trilogy and release it. But I just want to sort of make sure I'm diving back in and stirring the pot and just having all the ideas marinate and come to fruition. And so that was a good thing to work on. Already told you guys about my short film. I finished finally James Patterson's novel writing masterclass. And it was a great class. To be really honest with you, two things I noticed about the course. One, the course is most helpful for writers who are really, really at the very beginning of their career. And when I mean, and that's not to say that I'm not at the beginning, I sort of am, but I've already done two novels and I'm already like working on like several others. And so I have a system in place now that, in terms of like plotting and writing and stuff like that. So the class was helpful, but it wasn't as helpful to me as it would have been, say, in 2011, when I was still sort of struggling with all these ideas and trying to figure out how to put them together, and very much in the early stages of figuring out that I wanted to be a full-time creative and full-time writer. And again, like if you've written several novels, the class will have some nuggets for you, but for the most part, you'll find that you have a lot of these things down. At the same time, it's always really fascinating and interesting and important to get a perspective from literally the best-selling novelist in the entire world. So if for nothing else, just to hear what he has to say about the publishing industry and the writing process is valuable because he's more successful than all of us, like literally all of us. He's like the best. His novels are number one on the charts all the time, and he is the most successful novelist right now. Aside from J.K. Rowling, but she hasn't. She's amazing. This is not me putting J.K. down because she's amazing. She had her run with Harry Potter, and it was a nice long decade-long run. But in terms of like sort of like longevity, I think James Patterson pretty much has it in the bag right now. Again, that's not putting down J.K. because she's incredible, and I would give up my entire like chest cavity to have even like a modicum of the success that she has had. But you know, it's just important to notice the differences between the sort of lifelong longevity of James Patterson, and it's important to like sort of think about that when you're taking his class. So that's important. That's an important caveat. The second caveat that I want to put out there is that his class is really super helpful if you are thinking about getting into, when it's time to publish, if you want to go for traditional publishing. Like, I learned a lot about traditional publishing and how editors and agents look at your work. I mean, I knew a little bit about it, but as you guys know, I'm more indie. Like, I'm indie all the way. I love indie. Unless, like, I get approached like by a publisher with a really great deal, I probably will never be traditionally published. I queried at one point under the pressure of my friends and of people who actually, like, had no idea what they were talking about when it came to publishing. But I just did it just so I can have the experience and then just also see, like, how the market was responding to my book. And, you know, I did get the interest of an agent at Writer House at one point, but that fizzled out. And that's fine, like, you know, but I have decided pretty much that I want to be an independently published author, because I have full control over my work. I can hire the people that I want to hire to design the book, design the cover, edit the book. I have like a bigger team in terms of like getting beta readers on for the next book and just getting their feedback. And so I feel like I have my team in place, and I love like the feeling of just like I did this from beginning to end. In terms of traditional publishing, though, I have never been as deep in it as James Patterson has. Also, in terms of selling my work to Hollywood, I've never been as deep in it, like not even close, as James Patterson has. So he provides an invaluable perspective on not just writing and like building your craft, but also on traditional publishing. So if that's the route that you want to go, or it's a route that you may go for a few of your properties or all your properties in the future, definitely check the class out, because he's going to give you some really valuable insight. I learned a lot. And while I probably won't put it to use, it's just great to know. It's just great to know. It's great to, you know, like have that knowledge in my tool set, and be able to pass that on and just have it for myself and my own edification. Two things that I did as like a more emerging writer find useful from his class is his whole section on outlines. Now, this is not to say I have not been outlining, because I have like a very kind of almost psychotic 13-step process in place for the outlining of my novels. I'm pretty much a hardcore plotter, cinematic plotter in terms of writing novels. I love pantsing, but only within the confines of my plot, or only if I discover a really great direction, just sort of in a writing exercise, and I'll add that to the plot. So I can pants and I enjoy it, but for the most part, if I'm gonna get a novel finished, I have to have an outline, I have to have a plot. And his section on outlines and the way that he does them specifically, I found it very useful. And so it was a 12-step process before that I had, but now I literally took his section on outlines and added it to my own process, somewhere in between like step 10 and 11, I think I added his outlining process. So that's really valuable in terms of figuring out like how he does his outline. He also gives you an entire 20-page sample of the outline of one of his favorite books that he's written, Honeymoon, which is really helpful to just look at how he outlines not only his books, but how he sets up the thriller genre all as a whole. So, and just to see like how quickly his chapters move has really been influential to me in terms of like my future books. Because my genre is sci-fi and fantasy right now for Books of Ezekiel, I have thriller elements to it, but I can't necessarily adhere to the super quick like boom, 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 boom pace that James Patterson does, because there's a lot that needs to be introduced and explained. Not in a didactic and expository way, but just in a here's the world, let's show these parts of the world ways. But I have found that his thriller structure has been helpful for me in terms of speeding up the pace of my novels. And actually, from my readers' feedback, the pace of my novels is already really great, according to my readers. I'm not saying this myself. I'm just telling you what my readers have told me. They love the pacing. They feel it's actually really quick and on point. But I love James Patterson's pacing because it's just, like, it hits you like bullets. And I really like that. So, you know, there's a time and place and situation for everything. And my current series is not necessarily the place to use a thriller genre pacing. But I can get as close to that pacing as possible by taking some of James Patterson's points. He also has a really great chapter on writing suspense on, I think he called it building chapters. Yeah, building chapters and writing suspense. So those three, the outlines, the suspense, and the building chapters, I found the most helpful for me in terms of just, again, his perspective on how to do these things. He also has a really great section on, writing collaborations, which I think is great. I was considering that in the future. It's hard for me to collaborate, not because I can't, but because when I start a project, I have a pretty strong vision of what I want happening there. And so, you know, there's not really much that I'd be able to offer another author in a collaboration process. It would just feel like I'm just taking over. But I'm still open to doing collaborations. It would just have to be an idea that author and I come up with together and have different things to bring to the process. That's in terms of novel writing. In terms of screenwriting, I have very specific strengths and weaknesses. I think my dialogue is strong. In terms of like evoking character through dialogue, I think my pacing in screenwriting is pretty strong. Right now, let's say decently strong. Let's put it that way. And in terms of having like a cinematic plot structure, that is strong. What I could use for in a partnership is someone who is more adept at creating character and just being able to like evoke more character, to evoke more beautiful imagery in a screenplay, because again, like even though you're writing a screenplay, you're writing for the film medium, so you have to sort of show people the movie. And so I think that in a partnership, and just having a fresh set of eyes, that is sort of, those are the strengths and weaknesses that we would have to both bring to the table. And the skill sets would have to be complementary skill sets. I'm open to collaboration. I'm just sort of trying to figure out where that would fit in novel world. And it seems like it wouldn't really fit that great there, but for screenwriter world and filmmaking world, like collaboration is, you know, I can totally do that. And you sort of have to, because it's a collaborative medium. But back to James Patterson, he basically has an entire chapter on how he collaborates. And, he also allows his two collaborators to weigh in on their side of the process. And so it's interesting to look at it from that point, and I think it's pretty cool. So that's my review of his class. I think it's a great class to take no matter what level you're at, but it's going to be the most useful for those who are in the aspiring writer to just emerging writer stage. If you've already done like 10 or so novels and you've had some relative success, it's not going to be as useful for you, I think. Unless you haven't been successful, and then maybe you just want his perspective. But regardless of where you are, those things that I've highlighted, if any of those things interest you, then it's worth investing in the class. I feel like it was a fantastic $90 well spent. So now, moving from that class, I'm going to dive more deeply into the Aaron Sorkin class and try to finish that up before the end of the semester, so that when Shonda Rhimes' class comes out, then I can do that. And I'm also thinking about taking Werner Herzog's class as well. So Shonda Rhimes has a TV series writing class is coming out, which I think is amazing, because I am trying to produce my own independently done TV series at some point in the future. And then Werner Herzog has a filmmaking and directing class, which obviously, like, it's Werner Herzog, so you should check it out. Okay, so just to finish off, I keep saying just to finish off, but this is getting so long, but you guys know me. What else? Oh, I've okay. In terms of marketing, the cover for Hollow Point is done. I'm not revealing it just yet. That will be a part of my launch sequence, and I will be recruiting beta readers for Hollow Point in the next 2 months or so. Probably by the end of May, I'll be recruiting beta readers for that, and then sending it to my editor and then releasing it in July. So stay tuned for that. Stay tuned for the cover reveal. It's a really, I love the cover. It's great. It's like there's something like really gritty and like hyper realistic about it, but then it's also sort of has an urban fantasy feel, but then it's also like in sort of album, it's like a like a, there's like an album cover type feel to it too, which is kind of weird, but I like it a lot. It's great. And it fits in the brand. What else? The Bohemian Badass. So I not only worked on my Plot Like a Badass course, which is finally coming close to completion. I just have one more for my template, for my plotting template. I only have one more step to finalize in terms of like that module. And then I'll be able to start recording the modules, creating the slideshow, PowerPoints, and then putting together the worksheet. So I worked on that, and that's been coming along great. I have a bunch of beta testers ready to test out the whole course, and so I'm excited about that. That'll also probably come out sometime during the summer, but I will be hosting webinars probably towards the end of spring on cinematic plotting. So stay tuned for that. I also, if you haven't, if you're not subscribed to the Bohemian Badass, which is understandable because I don't think I have any opt-in places on my website, check out our blog and our podcast. I recently posted a film analysis of Akira Kurosawa's Throne of Blood, which I adored. I just watched it like 2 weeks ago and wrote a paper on it. So I and it's great to really watch the film as well as check out the analysis. And you'll find analyses of Throne of Blood on the internet all over the place. I mean, Kurosawa is like a legend, so I'm not the first person to do it, but I am the first person to do it on the Bohemian Badass as a blog post. So check that out. I also recorded and uploaded podcast number 3 for the Bohemian Badass, the Be Badass podcast, and that is on building fempires and basically takes you through literally a 2-hour journey of my development and emergence as a creative person. Pretty much spanning, it was supposed to be a 6-year sort of summary of my progress and development. But it ended up also being like a really brief, like I added on a summary of my development as an artist from 2006 all the way up until pretty much 2016. It was supposed to be a 6-year sort of overview of my journey, but it sort of turned into like a 10-year overview, which is why it's so long. I should put it in the title special podcast. But I think you guys will find some interesting nuggets just sort of looking back between like now and when I first started to realize, okay, I'm gonna make my writing dreams sort of come true or whatever. Looking at my development between 2006 and 2016, like the person I was then, both individually and also as a creative person, a writer, a filmmaker, and a business developer, is completely different now than who I was then. So, and it's great, and I'm looking for another 10 years of development, you know, God willing. And check it out. So the Bohemian Badass is officially back in vogue, back on track, and the next podcast will be on dealing with haters. It's very important to listen to that in terms of knowing how to keep persevering even if you're not being supported, or worse, if you're being denigrated like openly and overtly, which has happened to me. And I don't mean just random people throwing hate on like a book review. I'm talking about individuals actively telling me I'll never make it. I'm not worth anything. I'm not shit. You know, like that has literally happened to me. So I have basically run the entire gamut of experiencing hateration from the most, you know, covert, insidious minutia to the most overt, just like obvious outright attacks and defamation of character. So I can provide a lot of perspective on how that's affected me and the kind of like armor that I've had to put on in order to weather that storm. So definitely check that out. That's coming out tomorrow at some point. Okay, so that's the Bohemian Badass and what I've been doing there. And so I'm trying to stay on track with my Tuesday podcast and my Thursday blog post. So crossing my fingers on that one. And that's pretty much it. I mean, you know, today is the first day back at graduate school. Droopy face, frowny face. And so obviously, you know, like, I'm ready for it. It's part of me is a little disappointed, not because the program is bad, but because after you've experienced what you like truly love to do and what you want to do with your life for a whole week, and you've had that taste, that succulent taste of like the forbidden fruit, you don't want to go back to your daily grind. But I'm ready. You know, I spent yesterday sort of getting mentally prepared, physically prepared, just organized, figuring out what my projects are, when they're due, what I need to do for them. I have a lot of grading to do this week. Sure, my supervisor is going to be looking at me like, why didn't you do this over spring break? But that's okay. And then I'm doing my documentary for my race, class, and gender class. So, you know, a lot going on in the next 7 weeks. We also have a portfolio review due at the end of the semester. And I'm just going to do my best to power on through. What I've decided to do is spend the first 2 hours every morning just doing things for me, doing things for my personal care, and also doing things for my business, my marketing, and my writing. Those are my priorities from like 6, I would say maybe probably 5 to 7 every single morning. And then, you know, get the baby ready for daycare and all that, and start my day and go to grad school and do the damn thing. But from like 4:30 or 5 to 7 every morning, that's going to be, from 5 to 7, it's going to be like my time to work on my business and to do what I have to do and to write. Also probably in the evenings as well, anywhere between 5 to 7 on the days that I am free. So 4 hours a day, I'm going to dedicate to writing and all of that. And the rest of that time is going to be specifically for graduate school. Weekends, I'm going to try to do half and half. And just power through. You know, it's only 7 weeks. It's going to go a lot faster than it feels like it's going to go. And so I'm trying not to get complacent, trying to stay on top of my game. So this is the first day, so wish me luck, and of course, I will be back in touch with you guys. I'm still reading a lot of plays. I haven't really had much time for books this semester, but I have been reading a lot of plays, and so writing analyses on those, and not only for my classes, but also posting those as reviews on Goodreads and on my website. And doing that. So as you can see, for graduate school, like in addition to actually doing the thing for graduate school that I have to do, I'm also trying to make the things I do for grad school double count in terms of keeping up with my blogs, my author brand, and also keeping my creative training on point and spinning. So that's what you guys have to do. Just as a lesson, if your life is, if you have that flexibility to make things count for double, or to kill like 3 birds with 1 stone, then do that. Like I had to spend a lot of time, not last Friday, but the Friday before, writing that Akira Kurosawa paper. But then I turned that into an epic blog post for the Bohemian Badass. You know, like you got to do what you got to do. So anyway, in the meantime, keep it indie if you want. Stay badass, keep creating, and I will talk to you guys very soon, okay? Have a great rest of your week. If I don't see you, I'll probably try to check in around Wednesday or Thursday. But if I don't, you guys will definitely see me next week, all right? Stay in there, keep the hustle going, and love you guys, all right? Bye.